picchiare sopra i tetti un aeroplano che se ne va. Azzurro, il pomeriggio è troppo azzurro e lungo per me. Mi accorgo di non avere più risorse senza di te. E allora io quasi quasi prendo il treno e vengo, vengo da te. Il treno dei desideri, dei miei pensieri all'incontrario va. Innaffiando le tue rose, non c'è il leone, chissà dov'è.
Buongiorno, buon pomeriggio, buonasera. Qualunque cosa sia datiate, benvenuti all'episodio 5.
Welcome back. The fifth episode of My Way Kitchen is dedicated to the Italian gastronomy. Therefore, today's appetizer is bean terrine. Entrée is home-smoked mackerel with cheese potato stalks and caramelized drunken peaches. And dessert will be lemon-tangerine bars with My Way twist. As you see, the la carte is very simple but fetching. Surprisingly, some of you haven't realized that the background pictures or panorama that I frequently change in my shows are simply kitchen curtains. I order them online. I hang them with magnets. Today, I want to start our joint journey with magnetic words. Omnes viae Romam ducunt. All roads lead to Rome. We are talking about the prosperous empire that was once destined to rule the world. Unlike the ancient Greek philosophers who would normalize the complex controversy of the human nature, the Romans were crispy thinkers. Much of their philosophy followed the win-or-lose dichotomy, where the one who won was right. Italy, the remaining nuclear state of once glorious Roman Empire, is not just a country. From the landlocked Umbria, Italy's green heart, also known for the hilltop medieval towns, or coastline Campania, home of Naples, Puglia, home of the Adriatic Trulli, to the radiant Tuscany, home of Florence, splendid Lazio, home of Rome, or Lombardy, home of Milan, Italy is not just a state, it is universe. Life is opinion. I quote Marcus Aurelius, one of the respected Roman emperors and Stoic philosophers, who has also said, "We all love ourselves more than others, but we care more about others' opinions than our own." The great vision and competence were reflected in his confidence. So were those in the Romans who picked up perfect cobblestones to install 372 roads to convey their vision throughout Eurasia and beyond, roads that I named the arteries of civilization. The total length of the Roman roads reached 400,000 of kilometers, of which over 80,500 kilometers were stone paved. The roads, built by the Romans nearly 2,000 years ago, not only paved trails for civilization, but they still play a decisive role in the modern tourism industry. I have pledged to write travel books depicting all 372 Roman roads, and I have written about 12 roads so far, both in prose and stanza, and in pourquoi genre. You can find my books in Amazon Market under my former name, Naira Matevosyan, the name I still use in my endless authorship. For those who are unfamiliar with my writing style, I have authored multi-genre books, currently 174 in count, in law, medicine, history, arts, junior friendly, travel diaries and more. Frankly, the junior friendly books that I have written and illustrated are the products of my self-healing process to cope with the overwhelming number of traumas, often overlapping, inflicted by the mentally defective hooligan nobodies from Massachusetts whom I name the mistakes of nature, who torture themselves before they would torture others. This is a matter of separate long conversation and I don't want to spoil this presentation by that. Rather, I plan to write a book about the two decades of malicious war against me. Let's go back. Personally, I am transfixed not only by the Roman culture, architecture, or history, but also by the impact of female figures, among them Catherine de' Medici, an Italian noblewoman from a powerful and one of the richest European families, the Medicis from Florence, a dynasty of bankers who were patronaging Renaissance artists such as Da Vinci, Donatello, Caravaggio, Brunelleschi, Raphael, Michelangelo, and scientists such as Galileo Galilei, who also worked as a tutor for the Medici children. Catherine's childhood was rather tragic. Both parents died in the first months of her infancy, and she was raised by her paternal grandma Orsini, after by her aunt, then taken hostage and placed in a series of convents. Just 14, Catherine married to King Henry II of France, becoming the queen consort for 12 years, and even a regent for three of her sons, future kings of France. The first son was Francis II, who by the way was the first husband of Mary of Scots and who died very young from ear infection. The second son was Charles IX. The youngest was Henry III. Catherine's two daughters too married kings. Catherine de' Medici outlived all her nine children out of 10, except of her favorite son, Henry III, who died 7 months after her death. Catherine ruled France during the religious and civil wars. Despite of being remembered as a villain, Catherine de' Medici managed to leave a long-lasting legacy for her actual support of the arts, bringing ballet to the French court, lavish and spectacular banquets, principles of dining etiquette, introducing perfumed gloves to France and overall installing an age of better elegance in France. Although it is believed that perfume has been originated in Mesopotamia in 1200 BC, its industry has been prospered in the 16th century Renaissance Italy, refined and taken to France by Catherine de' Medici's personal perfumer René Le Florentin.
Catherine's chefs offered the French royal court a taste of Italy by introducing aspics, ice cream, cream puffs, custards, marmalades, mousse, and macaroons. Being a controversial figure, Catherine de' Medici still is legendary, and I place her in my top list of most favorite influential queens in Europe. Back to my kitchen. The Italians are known as fan di fagioli, bean fans. Ergo, it is not surprising that bean has a special place in today's menu. To my knowledge, there are more than 30 types of beans, and I only mean beans per se, not legumes, because beans are legumes, but not all legumes are beans. For instance, lentils, peas, tamarinds, acacia, carbos, peanuts, brooms are legumes, but not beans. Here I have only 7 types of beans. Cranberry beans, pinto beans, yellow-eye beans, fava beans, tolosana beans, white cargamanto beans, and even fresh drumstick beans. There. The best choice for terrine will be cranberry beans mixed with a bit of tolosana beans and cargamano beans for rich taste and color. You can drastically reduce the cooking time and energy if you soak the beans in warm water overnight or for 5 hours at least, so water will break and remove some heavy proteins from the skin and open the pores for cooking. The first stage of preparing terrine is making paste or pâté. As I've noted in episode 2 of my cooking channel, paste is terrine, but not all terrines are pastes. Terrines include roulettes, aspics, and paste. For preparing this paste, we need pre-cooked and smashed beans, white walnuts, garlic. I use my homemade garlic cream. Pomegranate seeds, olive or peanut oil, finely chopped dill, salt and seasoning per choice. My default spices are ground coriander, nutmeg, allspice, peppercorn and cumin seeds. The process of making vegetarian terrines resembles decorative gardening, where natural objects are transformed to look fictitious, part of a canvas. I will need a terrine mold, cling film, paper towel, as all ingredients must be dried, pre-cooked pandan leaves, leeks, asparagus, chives, carrots cut into quarter an inch, broccoli, king oyster mushrooms, boiled eggs, capers, pitted green olives, star fruits, pre-roasted orange bell peppers, melted butter, sharp knife and kitchen brush. Yucca root? Likely not. The cooked yucca is starchy, chewy, absorbing and absolute non-starter for any paste. While choosing asparagus, make sure that it is tender so it breaks easily. The ready bean paste contains unroasted white walnuts, finely chopped fresh dill, garlic, seasoning and olive oil. That's simple. I will save a handful of it for later stuffing of puff pastry shells and I will use the rest in making terrine. Meat terrines are prepared on the water bath in Balmoral. But I'm making a vegetarian terrine where almost all ingredients are already pre-cooked and edible. I just need to stuff the mold with paste, assemble the veggies, decorate and put in the freezer to chill. The first thing we need to do is to line the tray with double-layered and lightly buttered cling film.
In this case, cling is better than the plastic wrap, as it doesn't stick well. I line the tray tin with pandan leaves and leeks, overlapping them to avoid gaps and letting the ends of leaves hang over. Then I go all way perpendicular. I spoon some paste to pack it on the floor firmly. Over my process, I will assemble pre-seared king oyster mushrooms, capers, olives, chives. To hold chives together in a line, I rub the bunch this way. Then goes another layer of paste spread evenly over the top. Ideally, the asparagus must be just about the length of the tray. I put the asparagus tied to each other by placing every second stem reversed, so it'll get a really unyielding fit. Now there is a compact squeeze, but it is just what I need. All ingredients, except for the paste, must be dry and chilled. Grated and sweated carrots, broccoli, roasted orange peppers cut into strips, star fruits, boiled eggs, and the rest per imagination. After, I pull the leek and pandan leaves over the top. Lastly, I cover with the cling film, getting it to good press down to ensure that filling gets between the gaps. I then put the finished terrine in the fridge for 4 hours before slicing. You may be able to get away with just 2 hours, but the extra time doesn't hurt. Once chilled, it will hold the shape and will be easy to slice. Now let's roll over. I need an extra brace as I'm a bit nervous. Good enough. Let's slice it up. If you think that making a good terrine is the end point of a charcuterie platter, think twice. You must keep going by garnishing the dish. Here I have radish and vine tomatoes cut in half and stuffed with the sauces of contrasting colors. Remember, the clue in charcuterie platter is in contrasting colors and tastes. As you remember, I saved a handful of bean paste. Let's make a bean salad and stuff the puff shells, or as the French name it, a vol-au-vent. Almost like the lobster Newburgh, but only with beans instead of lobster tails. The puff pastry shells are versatile and easy to bake. Those who are lazy may consider using this ready panettones for stuffing the bean paste. But I want to bake the shells myself. I use the frozen puff pastry dough, usually comes vignetted in panels. Some oatmeal flour on the workstation. Brush the panels with egg wash to seal the pieces together. Feel free to experiment with different designs. I made 2 pastries from 1 panel because I egg washed between the layers. For each shell, I make a small circular cut in the upper layers. one last egg wash and sprinkle with sesame seeds. Put the shells in a well preheated 400 degree Fahrenheit oven. For about 25 minutes. When you switch off the oven, put the shells back with the oven door open, so they will cool down slowly and get crispier. Remove the cups with a steak knife and dress with the bean salad which I'm about to make. I whisk heavy cream with egg yolks . Finally, chopped purple onion or shallots, chopped celery. Finally, chopped fresh herbs like thyme, parsley, and cilantro. Pepper and freshly ground nutmeg seeds. Put in the buttered pan, medium heat, and stir with the spatula constantly until thick. Then mix it with the paste. Pre-roasted bacon. And fresh thyme. Spoon the must over the pastry puffs. Sprinkle with pomegranate seeds. And enjoy with the morning hot chocolate for an unusual starter. If you are a Weight Watcher avoiding pastry, then simply spoon your salad in a nice bonbon bowl and enjoy it with a cracker. You may have noticed that per each episode, I share one or two pieces from my solid silverware collection from the British, Russian, and German masters. I have a separate presentation about the reading of silver marks. Check it in my other YouTube channel where I present lectures in law, in trademark law. For this episode, I have this gorgeous antique British tazza bowl from solid sterling silver dating 1903, the Edwardian reign. Although it is Edwardian, made in London, by its style, it resembles the Greco-Roman Ionic column, the Justice design. I also have another confetti bowl from Sheffield office dating 1898. But for this presentation, I selected the Edwardian bowl as it looks Roman, doesn't it? Let me magnify the marks for you. The standard mark or the lion percent indicates the sterling purity per thousand. The town mark is Leo's face, corresponding to London. The date letter is small h. As referred in the catalog, it was made in 1903. Why not in 1823 or 1883? Because this bowl is not marked by a duty mark. The 1823 and 1883 marks contain the monarch's duty marks that discontinued in about 1890. The first one has George IV's head, the one before William IV, and the second Queen Victoria's profile. Besides, the date letter H is fancier in the two other marks in Castellar and Harrington fonts correspondingly. Therefore, this bonbon bowl was made in London during the Edwardian reign. It is 118 years old. This one was made in Sheffield, England, in 1898, according to the date letter, a fancy small letter F. The town symbol is crown, corresponding to Sheffield. The purity is sterling, marked by the lion passant, and the maker is Charles Edward Nixon. This one is German, solid silver, 800 purity parts per thousand. This is from Hanau, made in 1850. The master is Johann Sigmund Kurz. And here is this German 803 silver caddy spoon, again from Hanau, dating 1900, made by Ludwig Neresheimer. Typically it is for measuring dry tea, but today I will use it for this salad. I have 3 bulky mackerel marinated for 4 hours in the fresh lemon juice, spices of my choice minus paprika and basil leaves. The two sides, I gonna make cheese potato stacks and caramelized peaches. For what I have all ingredients ready for cold, including white wine, in this case I have Sauvignon Blanc. I also have charcoal and applewood for smoking the fish. What meal is complete without a side or a garnish? A great side dish complements the flavors on the main entree while boosting the nutritional value of the meal. If you are used to making entrees with red meats like beef, lamb, goat, or heavy poultry like duck, you might feel at a loss when you think about preparing a side with fish. Part of what sets seafood apart from other meats is that it is lighter. It pairs best with sides that are filling without being heavy. It always goes well with potatoes, citrus flavors, or caramelized fruits. While the fish is on the grill outside, let's prepare the potato stacks. Any large size potato will work, such as Idaho potatoes, Yukon Gold potatoes, King Edward potatoes, Delaware, Kennebec, or Ganda. What I have here are red King Edward potatoes. I like red, as it looks nice if slided and stacked in the columns. This slicer is adjusted for about 1/4 inch slices. Leaving the red skins, I cut the potatoes into thin slices. I drain the juice. Then add melted butter and olive oil with higher burning point. I also spray with ground Gouda and Parmesan. Salt, freshly ground pepper, freshly ground nutmeg, sesame seeds, I shake or gently mix the slices so the seasoning will incorporate. I have a set of muffin molds already buttered. I layer the slices into 2 to 3 inches high vignetted stacks and put in the preheated 375 degree Fahrenheit oven for 15 minutes until the edges and tops are golden brown and the middles are tender. I leave them to rest for 5 minutes. Then I gently remove the stacks from the tray molds and sprinkle again with freshly ground black pepper, lemon zest, and thyme. Oh boy, these are pretty. King Edward would be proud of me for my handling of his potatoes, the red King Edward spots. Just kidding, deep breeze, people. Now let's dress the dish. The fish is well smoked and juicy. Let's sprinkle with lemon zest, thyme and pomegranate seeds. To caramelize the peaches, in the saucepan goes 1/3 a cup of granulated sugar cooked until fully melted in the medium-low heat. I also add a bit of maple syrup. I add butter, lemon juice, vanilla extract. I add cloves and sliced peaches and stir together. I add white wine. And cook for 5 minutes. In the last 2 minutes, I add ground Edo's nuts to indurate the fruit slices. Served with fish, you can drizzle on top with the remaining liquid or rum or wine. Try it and revel. The Italian dessert system is vast, affording over 100 pastries, biscuits, creams, gelatos, custards or confection. Each region has its own staple dessert. For example, amaretti is known for belonging to Liguria region. Baba was invented in Naples, Campania region. Bonnet in Piedmont. Bratteboni in Prato, Tuscany region. Cannoli in Sicily, Pestociotti in Puglia, Rocciata in Umbria, Sabrisolona in Lombardy, Sebada in Sardinia, Schuelatella in Campania, Tartufo or Truffle in Calabria, Tiramisu in Veneto, Torta Barosi in Emilia-Romagna, etc. But today I'll keep things simple. By baking lemon bars with my addition, combining lemons and tangerines. I recommend using tangerines instead of mandarins because the former has richer and satiated orange color, good for the filling. Lemon bars are extremely popular throughout the United States and are also linked to Italy's Campania region. For the crust, I use 2 sticks of room temperature butter and 1/2 cup of granulated sugar. While the mixer is on low, I add 2 cups of all-purpose flour and a teaspoon of salt. This is like a shortbread dough, easy to make. I pad it right into the 8x11 inches pan. There is no need to grease the pan in advance as the crust dough is already buttery. I flour my hands with oatmeal flour and press the dough for the even distribution. I put it to chill for about 15 minutes. After, I bake it for about 15 minutes. Now it's time to add the filling. I whisker together 6 eggs, 3 cups of sugar. I add grated lemon zest, about 2 to 3 tablespoons, and the same amount of tangerine zest. Then a cup of fresh lemon juice and half a cup of tangerine juice. I already smell that pleasant citric sharpness. Now I add a cup of all-purpose flour slowly in small portions so the batter will not get lumpy. Technically, the lemon bar filling is a lemon omelet, if you will. I pour it on the crust and put back to the oven for 350 Fahrenheit for about 30 to 35 minutes. Now, these are settled. Let's cut. And after, dust them with confetti sugar. My modification also includes chocolate or cocoa powder. Almonds. And sesame seeds. Let's try the first piece. So soft, just delightful. Spero ti sia piaciuto il mio spettacolo. Sottoscrivi. Ciao.